हेलो गाइस, टुडे वी हैव वन मोर ग्रेट पर्सनालिटी विद अस, मैडम अमृता राजपाल, फाउंडर ऑफ एजुकार्ट एंड एक्सपर्ट एजुकेशनिस्ट. शी इज पैशनेट अबाउट क्रिएटिंग लर्निंग एनवायरनमेंट्स दैट आर एंगेजिंग, मीनिंगफुल एंड फन. शी इज एसोसिएटेड विद सम ऑफ इंडियाज प्रीमियर एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट्स एज अ कंटेंट एंड सर्विस प्रोवाइडर. शी इज करंटली द टेरिटरी हेड ऑफ अर्ली चाइल्डहुड एसोसिएशन मुंबई. अ लार्ज पार्ट ऑफ हर लास्ट 20 ईयर्स एज एन एजुकेशनिस्ट has gone into researching best practices that focus on the development of the whole child as an inquirer both in the classroom and the world outside. Her wealth of experience includes being a preschool coordinator, franchisee, head of department operations, head of a large preschool chain and co-founder of Crasilact. Her education includes the postgraduate diploma in early childhood education from New Zealand Tertiary College. In addition, she has various certificate courses to her credit, a few of which are using multiple intelligences as a tool to help students learn, from Harvard Graduate School of Education, USA, and Understanding Learning Disabilities from Arya Vidya Mandir Institute of Special Education. So let's to have a start of a talk with Madam Amrita Rajpal.
Hello.
Hi, Harsh.
Hello, ma'am. How are you?
Very good, very good.
So, ma'am, how is your quarantine going on?
You can hear everybody at home and my dog also barking. So,
ma'am. Yeah, continue, please.
Lockdown is going on very well. I think not been at home for so long ever in my life, but this is the first. Yeah. What about you?
I think same. Well, we are still in lockdown. I don't know how long will it carry on.
You're in Calcutta?
No, UP, Lucknow.
Lucknow. Okay, all right. So this is Bombay, and Bombay is apparently the worst hit. Yes.
So ma'am, I think it will be little unfair if we have you and didn't ask about the journey of EduCart. Ma'am, please, we are eagerly looking to listen that.
About how EduCart came into existence. All right, so let me share my journey with you. I started my career in 98 as a coordinator in a preschool. In fact, in Kangaroo Kids as a coordinator. And I was a coordinator for 9 years. And I handled that center. After that, I went on to, a large preschool chain. I went over there and I was part of the head office where I was the franchise head. And then I was the operations head of BrainWorks. And, I've set up more than 200 schools now.
Great.
And somewhere along the way at that time, I realized that there were a lot of people who wanted to start schools and they required the right guidance and they required someone to tell them what to do. As far as I was concerned, because I had experience in everything, franchising and operations and being a center coordinator, being a teacher, working in the education system for so many years, that I started another company with a friend and now I've started my own company, EduCart. Yeah, so this has been a long journey, more than 22 years, two decades of being in this education sector, and it has been most satisfying.
Great, ma'am. So moving to today's topic discussion, that is impact of COVID-19 on Indian education system. So ma'am, my first question is, what do you think, how much we are prepared to fight this pandemic?
Right now, what I can say is we don't know so much about when this is going to stop for us to be prepared to fight the pandemic. This came with no history, this pandemic, that we had some experience in it. Just like when we have a history thing, we know we've fought this war and what are the learnings from the war and what should we not do next time. It's always been a learning and that learning has been implemented. Right now in this situation, there has been no learning. It's a first-time experience for everyone. So we really don't know what we are supposed to be doing. You know, everyone is just floundering, working their way around, figuring out what to do. If you see how has COVID affected education, you know, preschool education, I am a specialist in preschools. As I said, you know, my company gives content and curriculum, helps set up preschools. Preschool education was never given any importance. So it's correct, not children are going to school, they learn ABCD anywhere, or 1, 2, 3. No one really realized that the brain of the child till the age of 8 years has already expanded to 90%. So this is that vulnerable age, and it has really affected this age. And with schools closing down, there have been various kind of repercussions which have happened. You know, there have been some good and there have been some bad. It's not been only doom. It's also had its own share of pros. So if I'm going to be saying, people are realizing that preschool education is important. It's not only about learning ABCs. There's a physical development happening. There's a cognitive development happening. There's social development happening. There's emotional development happening. You know, all these things together, along with, you know, being with other people, learning with co-construction, learning from your peers, learning from your teachers. All that is required to teach a child. I think right now parents are realizing that preschools are not to be taken lightly, that they are doing a great job. There is something to it, and it is a necessity and not, you know, a luxury, so to speak. Another thing which is affecting education right now is the government mandate that below 10 years, children will be coming last to school because they are at high risk, which is the truth. No, immunity systems are lower. So if this doesn't come on, then I'm just thinking about what will happen about preschool owners. And what about the rents they will pay? What about the teacher sustenance? What about everything? It's not talking about something in a bracket. No, I'm not talking about one small part of it. I'm talking about a whole ecosystem that is there. This is an organic ecosystem. It has a whole business by itself, but it doesn't provide only a service, which can be saying, I don't want to buy this dress, so I will not buy it. Education doesn't work that way. So there have been a lot of pros and cons. I can also say there have been a lot of opportunities at this point, because if you see the trainings which are available for teachers, Howard is giving out trainings at, they're free trainings actually being given out by most places. You know, big online courses have come out. Professionals like myself are giving out trainings for a tuppence. You know, 1/50th or 1/100th of what we would charge. Because this is the time to collaborate and get everybody on one thing. There's also a thing about digital, acceptance happening. A person like me would never have thought of having a Zoom meeting. I would have flown down to UP, you know, or had a meeting with the school principal in that place, in that atmosphere, or have that person come to me, because this is where our comfort levels lie. But now Zoom meetings are coming on. Teachers are interacting online. So I think education has been affected adversely as well as it has had its pros.
As we have seen right now, every school is moving for some online solution. So what do you think, correct, how much feasible and accessible is online system is?
So now when I've been speaking about changes, this has been the largest change. You know, Harsh, when I'm just seeing, till now, online and children were never synonymous. It was always a separate thing. When I speak about gadgets, I don't speak about children at the same time. It's like two different entities totally. But right now, this has brought them together. So I can see, if people are looking at assessments, if people are looking at learning your ABCs and your 1, 2, 3s, I don't think that is possible. First of all, at home, we don't have the resources what a school has. So you don't have your puppets, you don't have your books, you don't have your flashcards, you don't have resources to teach. And teaching aids really aid teaching. That's why they call teaching aids. They help you to teach. Because a child at this point is at a sensory motor stage, which is, you know, a stage where they're using their senses and they're using their movement abilities. They want to touch, feel everything. They want to have, an interaction with a person. However, a digital tool also is a sensorial object in some way that you can have a visual connect, you can have an auditory connect, you cannot have a kinesthetic connect. But there can be something like meeting your peers, having some sort of connection with your teachers, that is possible. However, it comes with a lot of cons again. We are talking about tier one cities. A person in Bombay possibly will have a gadget. Everyone will have a gadget. And they may be able to give that gadget to their child for a, few hours to the child. But when I'm looking at tier two cities, tier three cities, what are the internet resources available? What is, do they have those digital tablets or, whatever digital tools to be able to give that to their child? Is that reach over there for them? So I think it comes with a lot of connotations for different people. However, I must say that 20 minutes is the most that a child can stay online at a time. They need a break after that. They cannot be sitting forever on a tool. And the only reason that an online connection to teach is possible is because it is an engagement with someone where they're not viewing it mindlessly. You know, when you're viewing a TV mindlessly or a TV show or a cartoon, then there is only one thing which is happening where your brain is just going into a zone. But here there is an interaction. So that's why this kind of engagement is possible and it is good. However, if you're looking at assessing children, this is not the space for the time to do it, and it's not possible, not for preschoolers.
All right, so ma'am. It was a wonderful answer. Ma'am, moving to my next question, which we have seen generally these days arising, we have visited many online platforms. The question which is common nowadays, which is it right decision for, will government can take, or we can say that it will be the right decision to cancel for the cancellation of one academic year?
See, right now, no, the whole focus is not on is it right or is it wrong. Today, people are looking at life taking more precedence than money. If you see our economy, which is going to have, it's going to have major repercussions on the economy right now. You know, people are staying at home, they're not going to work. And this is not about preschools. We're talking about all businesses. I'm talking about something as big as an Uber, which is going to face a big backlog. But what have we decided? We have prioritized our life more than we have prioritized money. So if the government has to take that kind of decision, it will be a very informed decision that the government will take. Keeping in mind all these things, I think all of us are not able to sleep properly, but I can imagine what our Prime Minister and all our ministers must be going through. They must be just in so much stress because they're not only looking at one business, they're looking at the whole country as a whole. So I don't think we are in a position right now to say what is right and wrong, because we are not in their position looking from a top-down perspective and deciding and prioritizing, everything which is happening. Right now, I know if you start a preschool and you're looking at social distancing for a five-year-old, child is going to a school with a mask. The teacher is wearing a mask. The child doesn't know whether the teacher is smiling or she's, upset because the mask is covering the face. What if one child goes and pulls out another mask from another child? What if he goes and, suddenly sneezes, or maybe he has touched something and touched the child? Where is the control in all this? And how much can a teacher see? So I think right now we need to keep those decisions for, you know, the health experts, government experts, which are going to look at all this in a very holistic manner. They're going to look at it very broadly and then make a decision, rather than just looking from my bird's eye view and saying, no, I think the school should start because teachers have to be paid, because rents have to be paid, because they have to. It's quite a situation right now, because maintenance of rents, you know, maintenance of schools, paying rents to people, not being able to get fees from parents. Preschools are going through a lot of upheavals at this point. You know, teachers' salaries are dependent. There is, as I said, watchmen, DDs, bus drivers, a lot of other connects which are there, which are dependent. And the dependency is, as I said, it's an organic thing. It's an ecosystem by itself. It is not a product. Education cannot be said that it is a product. It is life-changing. It is transforming. You cannot talk about a teacher and say, you know, she has a job. She doesn't have a job. She has a job is one part, but she has a responsibility, which is a different part. So I think we cannot equate that, the responsibility to the job. I know a lot of teachers right now who are putting in, taking in so much trouble to learn all this. You know, this whole digitization, to just be there for the children. So I think, you know,
I'm not in a position to take this decision right now.
We cannot comment on this right now. This is not a thing for us to be able to comment.
I totally got your point, ma'am. So ma'am, one question that is, what can be the learning for all of us from this pandemic?
I think there have been many learnings in this. There have been many. The first learning that has happened is in health, hygiene, you know, cleanliness. So these are all the things which have to be taken seriously. It is not a question that, you know, we'll just be lax in our thing, that we can, you know, just be unhygienic or keep the city dirty or throw away tissues or whatever. I think building your health, building your immunity has been the first takeaway from this epidemic for everybody. Let it be from the child to the oldest person that there is. A second thing that is there is people have realized they need to have a balance in their life. You know, the balance has to be between family, has to be between their social life, between their work. I think now that people are staying at home, they are realizing, you know, a different ecosystem of a house. Otherwise, everyone is living quite a lot of individual lives.
They are getting a chance to explore themselves.
Yeah, explore themselves, their members of their family, the systems. I think that has also been a big learning curve out here. Another thing has been that everyone has realized they need to upgrade their skills. You know, all of us possibly have not paid so much attention, especially in the education sector. Most of the people have not paid attention to digitization. You know, it's not been because it's always been an interface and teachers communicate with children on a face-to-face, and I'm talking about preschool. But they realize that digitization has to be a part of it now. I think blended learning will be the new normal. So that is one thing which has come up for us. And another thing is the learning that has happened for most parents, that it's not about ABC and 1, 2, 3. Learning is about life skills. Learning is about all-round development of the child. I think now they're appreciating the teachers more. That, you know, that there is so much that is happening, because now with these online platforms, parents are sitting with their children and they realize endless learning from this epidemic.
So ma'am, what would you like to give the message to parents, as these days school are not open, so mostly the children are in their house, so how should they take?
Yeah. So I think right now I would just like to tell all parents, you know, to have less expectations from children and from yourselves. Because I think every parent wants to prove themselves to be a super mom. You know, they want to be available to do everything for everybody and also to be the best mother possible out here. I think it's okay just to be the way you are and to accept your child the way the child is. Focus on life skills, you know, and this other learning will happen. But look at caring, empathy, life skills. Look at, you know, teaching your child the right thing about keeping things in place, helping the grandparent, helping the parents. I think these are things and values which the child will understand. You know, connections with family, speaking to extended family. I think this should be the focus right now. Rather than, you know, have you finished your ABC, write 4 pages. I think that should not be the focus right now, because it's no point beating yourself up. And there is only so much as a parent that you can do. And of course, give time to the child. No, that is required. And however you are is the best. I think that's the thing I want to tell all parents.
All right, ma'am. So one more question, ma'am. As these days, all the students are in their houses and they are in under the four walls. So how much it has affected their mental health and what we can see its outcomes?
You know, this is a very nice topic that you touched on, Harsh. So there are functional families and there are dysfunctional families. And right now, when we're realizing that a child's growth of the brain is from 0 to 8 is about 80 to 90%. Can you imagine how much the impact of a good social and emotional climate will help the child? You know, right now the social and emotional climate is only the four walls of the house and the people in it, because nobody can move out. Correct? But this impact has so much on that child and also so much on the parents, because there are frustrations which are here, which are going down over there, and there are frustrations over there which are coming over here. So right now, to handle that, I think it's very important to set routines. You know, you stay with the routine constantly. There should be a fixed bedtime. There should be a fixed waking up time. There should be fixed meal times. You can bracket your day into big parts, you know, and say that, all right, we're going to have 1 hour of music and movement. Chalo, we'll put on some music and we can do something. Now we'll have 1 hour of art. Or now is helping mama time or helping clean the house, you know. So if you break up your day into parts, a child understands what is expected. Otherwise, a child is constantly bored, you know. Or a child has choices ki mujhe ye nahi karna hai, wo nahi karna hai. And tantrums start. But if this is what is set earlier and a child is explained to, hey, now beta, we are going to be at home for so many days and we are going to be setting our routine. So this time you're doing this, and now you also have your free time to do what you like, and I also have my free time to do what I like, you know. So you all can work your routines around, and I think a child actually likes routines, just like all human beings like rules. They all want to live in a world which has boundaries. A child also wants to have boundaries, and that will control the child and have a good social, a good emotional, you know, actually foundation set for the child. So, you know, being over there and being available, I think that is very important.
Absolutely, ma'am, a wonderful answer. Ma'am, one question, as you are already spent your many years into this field, so I would like to ask what we can expect its after effects.
So right now, you know, Harsh, when I'm looking at the after effects, I think, assuming that everything is going to go back to normal and we're going to go back to normal, I think right now there will be different types of trainings for staff, you know, the teachers as well as for the ancillary staff. And there will be different kinds of compliance is for schools. I think every school will have its own COVID compliance system, where you know you will have sanitization, you will have routines of cleaning toys and you know keeping things sanitized and whatever. I think staff will be trained differently. Blended learning will also have to be incorporated over here. So it is not only you know, the sanitization, cleanliness, safety measures, which will have to be upgraded, but I think also blended learning, where the parents connect. Because right now, I think parents and teachers both have realized that they are stakeholders of the child. The child is a shared responsibility. He is not only a teacher's child, nor is he only a parent's child. He lives in both the communities, a community of a school and a community of a family. And right now, this COVID-19 has brought both together. The school has reached the house. And the parent and the teacher have both actually become one in sharing to teach the child. Right? I think that will have to continue. And that will be a part of the new normal. So there will be a blended learning system which will be happening. So I think that will be the after effects.
So means we can conclude that as we haven't means generally seen these things in the child of a small age group, but those who are in teenager, they generally they have some communication gap with their parents. So this time will help to reduce it.
I think really if they decide and they work together as a family, I think it would be a wonderful thing, because the close proximity will only do, you know, will give you those kind of experiences and opportunities to do that. So I think that will be most wonderful. And as far as children are concerned, the younger children, I think this is a point where they will really learn what bonding is all about. You know, if a parent removes old photographs and sees, for me to imagine my mother as a young child was very, very difficult, because my mother was always a mother. She was never a child. You know, she must never have climbed a tree. She must never have got slapped by her mother. She must never have done anything naughty, because she's always telling me what to do. I think getting out old photographs, showing, talking about your childhood, talking about, you know, hearing nani dadi stories, connecting with them. I think all these are just giving wonderful opportunities. And now the globe has become small. It is not a different world. So if someone, family members are in America or in Timbuktu, the connect is as easy, you know. They can all come into your homes.
All right, ma'am. So moving to my last question, and that is, ma'am, do you think it will affect or it will change totally the system recently which we are following? Ma'am, as you have worked so much in preschool, so will it change the system of preschool or it will go as it is going before?
It will surely change. It has to change. I think people have understood health is important. They've realized immunity is important. They've realized sanitization, hygiene, cleanliness are the foundation for which we are alive today. And it is the foundation of our life, you know. So I think it has to change. The parent connect will only grow stronger. I think right now people who sustain their schools will only be sustaining on this basis, that they and the parents are one. Otherwise, they will not be able to sustain. So I think right now, because of all this close proximity, these things are a change which will stay. If I have been with my child sitting in an online class every day, I will be interested in what my child is learning. So a parent will be asking more questions, will be understanding more. And for a teacher wanting to know what the child knows in their school, what are they interested in, what is their routine, you know, what is the culture they are bringing in. I think just customizing learning will happen right now, you know, and inclusive learning, having everybody come and include their lives and their families into the learning. I think that is all going to happen. That is the new normal. I think our curriculums will also have to change. EduCAT specializes in making content, curriculum for schools, teacher development programs. And I am looking at revamping everything, because everything has changed, you know.
It was a ma'am excellent answer, and also it was an excellent interaction with you. Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving your precious time, and thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us.
It was a pleasure. Thank you so much for calling me. It was really good.
Thank you so much.